What's up? Medite here, and in this video, we'll be covering the whole anatomy of the diaphragm. So here we see the anterior view of the thorax and the abdomen. The lungs, as you see here, are located within the thoracic cavity, while organs like your liver and the intestines are part of the abdominal cavity. Now between the thoracic cavity and the abdominal cavity, there's going to be a large muscle called the diaphragm. And just by looking at the diaphragm, you can see that it consists of two main parts. There's the central tendinous part, and a muscular part around the central tendinous part. And the main reason why we need the diaphragm is because when the muscle fibers contract, they will pull the central tendinous part down, and that will increase the volume of the thoracic cavity and decrease the pressure so that air can easily come into the lungs. So the diaphragm is our main muscle of inspiration, one that we can't live without. So let's go ahead and isolate the diaphragm and understand the actual anatomy of it. So in this video, we're first going to cover the three origin points, which are the lumbar part, the costal part, and the sternal part. After that, we're going to look at the openings of the diaphragm, basically which structures go through it. And then we will see what type of coverings it has from both sides. So let's start with the origin points and do the lumbar part first. Now the lumbar attachment of the diaphragm is from this area, so let's go ahead and focus on that. The main thing you can see looking at the lumbar part of the diaphragm are two muscular fibers going down along the vertebral column, called the right crus and the left crus. The right crus being longer than the left crus, as you see here. So first off, don't get confused by this long structure here. It's called the suspensory muscle of the duodenum. It just goes down and grabs the duodenum to keep a certain part of it flexed. It is not a part of the origin points, and it is not a part of the lumbar part, so don't mind this structure for now. Alright. So the right crus is going to go down and attach at the vertebral bodies of L1 to L4. It really depends on person to person on how long this crus will reach, as you see here. But generally, L1 to L4 vertebral bodies are where the right crus will attach on. And then the left crus is going to attach at the vertebral bodies of L1 to L3. So that's these. Another thing you will find in the lumbar region are certain ligaments that's going to provide extra attachment points for the diaphragm. These are the lateral arcuate ligament and the medial arcuate ligament. The medial arcuate ligament is going to attach from the bodies of around L1, L2 and to the costal process of L1. And then the lateral arcuate ligament will go from the costal process of L1 to the 12th rib. The third ligament, which make up kind of a border for the diaphragm and provide an extra attachment point, is the median arcuate ligament, as you see here, going between the right and the left crus. Now, underneath the lateral arcuate ligament, you will see the quadratus lumborum muscle being bordered by it, and under the medial arcuate ligament, you'll find the psoas major muscle. Now, can you guess what structure go underneath the median arcuate ligament? Here's a hint, it's the aorta. So that was the main points that I wanted to get across when we talk about the lumbar part of the origin point of the diaphragm. Other origin areas are the costal part, or costal attachment, because as you see here, it's also going to originate at the inner surface of the 12th to the 7th rib. And then when it reaches the top side of the diaphragm, it's going to originate behind the sternum as the sternal part. So if we focus on this region, you will see that it also originates from the posterior aspect of the xiphoid process of the sternum. That was all the origin points of the diaphragm, the lumbar part, the costal part, and the sternal part. So fibers originate from these areas, and then they insert at the central tendinous part to pull it down and help bring air into the lungs. Awesome! I hope the diaphragm makes a little more sense now. Now, let's talk about the openings of the diaphragm. The main openings here are the caval openings, or foramen vena cava, the esophageal hiatus, and the aortic hiatus. Other openings we can find are the sternocostal triangle and the lumbocostal triangle, as well as small openings on the lumbar part as well. So let's start by looking at the diaphragm from this perspective. We will see that it looks like this. Again, the three main openings are the aortic hiatus, esophageal hiatus, and the caval opening. From the aortic hiatus, you'll find mainly the aorta going through it, as well as the thoracic duct. It's a lymph duct. The esophageal hiatus is going to provide an opening for the esophagus to continue as the stomach, as well as a passageway for the nervus vagus. The caval opening is going to provide an opening for the inferior vena cava to bring blood back into the right atrium of the heart, as well as a passageway for the right phrenic nerve. So that was the three main openings of the diaphragm. Then we have other small openings on the diaphragm. You see we have the costal cartilage, the sternum, and the diaphragm. These three structures are going to form a triangle called the sternocostal triangle. Through the sternocostal triangle, mainly, you're going to see the internal thoracic vein and the internal thoracic artery. So that's this one. The next triangle is a little special one. It's called the lumbocostal triangle. Chances are you've probably been searching around trying to understand the lumbocostal triangle, but there's not much written about it anatomically. The reason is because it's not a structure we should have. The lumbocostal triangle is actually a defect in the diaphragm, at around in this region. It is formed by the incomplete closure of the canal between the pericardium and the peritoneum, called the pericardioperitoneal canal. It is usually closed off by the pleuroperitoneal membrane. This defect looked like this. And in sources, you might find the lumbocostal triangle being called the Bochdalek foramen. Now this opening in adults is a potential opening for hernia, where a part of the intestines can get squeezed out so that it bulges into the thoracic cavity. So that's this one. Then we have numerous structures perforating the muscular part of the lumbar region of the diaphragm. Those can be structures like the esophageal vein and the splanchnic trunk and the sympathetic trunk. Now, lastly, let's understand how the diaphragm is covered. The part of the diaphragm that faces the thoracic cavity is covered by the endothoracic fascia, which is a fascia that covers the internal lining of the thoracic cavity. And while doing so, the endothoracic fascia is going to have the diaphragmatic part, in which is going to go over the diaphragm and cover it as well. Another thing that's going to cover the diaphragm is the parietal pleura of the lungs. The part of the pleura that covers the diaphragm is called the diaphragmatic surface. Now, the part of the diaphragm that faces the abdominal cavity is covered by the endoabdominal fascia, as well as the peritoneum. So that was everything I had for the anatomy of the diaphragm. I really hope this video made sense and that it helped you get a complete overview of the diaphragm.